Welcome to season two of Films in Black and White.
Yeah.
We are back. We are badder than ever. We are so excited that you all are joining us this week. We're so excited that you are here. We got some shit to talk about. A little bit of column A, a little bit of column P.
But a whole lot of column F.
That's right, a whole lot of column F. Well, this is season two, episode one. We're going with Bourne movies. So this is the podcast identity.
Oh, we're doing Jason Bourne.
We're doing Jason Bourne. So this is the podcast identity, season two, episode one. Again, super excited you all are here. You all may know me. My name's Doug Wagner. We're the one of the three co-hosts of Film in Black and White, but I need to invite my other two co-hosts into this conversation, and I'm going to kick it on over to the masked menace to my left on the Zoom window, the one, the only, Marcus J Destin. Marcus, yeah. How we doing?
I'm all right, man. I'm here. I got a whole lot of funk to get off my chest. I am here. Strictly playing sidekick to Brian Rouse today. That's it. I'm here quickly meeting the alley-oop man to Brian Rouse.
Oh, no.
Shit, we gonna get off our chest, but that's okay.
What a pleasure.
We back in season two, and it is a whole lot of funk coming y'all way. Y'all hear me?
We're bringing
it's
the funk, sure.
A whole lot of funk.
Yeah. I'm super excited. You're definitely fitting the role of the sidekick with that particular bright orange mask. Marcus told us earlier that he bought this specifically for the podcast. So was answering phone calls today. So it worked out well. I also have to introduce my other co-host, the one, the only Brian Roush. Brian Roush, how are you doing, sir?
Hello, everybody. I am here, and what interesting times do we live in? I'm doing well with saying that.
Okay, good. I think that's a good place to leave it. Look, I don't want to hit anybody with this, like, you know, Bernie Sanders, we once again are coming to you when our country is on fire. But here we are. We're coming to you again, once again, when our country is on fire. So season two started on the same day that everybody decided to storm
lose
the gates.
Lose their goddamn minds.
Yeah, just, basically lost their minds.
Just a minor insurrection, Doug.
Just,
really.
I mean, just some light treason. Like, not a really, not a big deal. Not a big deal at all. But I wanted to give, I mean, it's hard, right? I mean, this is, you're watching the foundations of your country kind of be torn asunder. So it's really important that we kind of talk about it. And I definitely wanted to give time to both Brian and to Marcus to express themselves, because that's, we have a platform and we need to speak our truth, whatever that may be. So I want to kick it over to whoever wants to go first, whether it's Marcus, whether it's Brian, it doesn't really matter to me.
I told you I am here to strictly pay sidekick to Brian Rouse.
Oh, okay.
Wow.
So I'm gonna tell you why when it's my turn, but as of right now, I am strictly just playing sidekick to Brian. Okay. I am the Robin to his Batman.
Oh, okay? Man.
That's incredible.
Wow.
That's
this
really
is an
special.
Honor.
That's really special.
I'm really excited. Matter of fact, let me cue up
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. All right.
Oh,
so
Nelly.
Brian. How are you doing? How are you processing this light treason?
Wow. You know, it sucks. I'm just going to say today was awful. If you're listening to this, it is January 6th, 2021. I have a feeling we're going to remember this date for a while. And yeah, a bunch of people went to the Capitol today and they were super violent and they broke in. And it just kind of feels like everything is awful and I really hate it. And it really sucks. And I know for some people that come to this podcast, I want to say this before I like go on a tear here, but like, I get if you're coming here, you want an escape and that's cool. I'm going to say you should probably fast forward like 7-10 minutes. Like, that's cool. We're going to get to that. Cause I need that too. I need an escape too. But I also think it's important that we acknowledge like the awfulness that is currently happening and that did happen, because if we don't, we're not using our platform responsibly, we're not being good servants of our community. And to say that what happened today of white supremacist fascist people going into the Capitol is not okay and it's awful and it sucks and I really hate it. It goes against everything I've ever been taught about the nation that we're in, and to see people disrespect it, to disrespect the process, to hold up a legitimate process is really hard to process and really hard. It's even harder when you can't do anything about it. Like, we're all watching it on our phone. It is absolutely wild that we're seeing an attempted insurrection like on our phone as we're like getting our lunch ready. Like, it's just bonkers, and I have no idea how to process it. Doug and Marcus have been hearing my thoughts pretty much kind of throughout the day. I didn't even know if I was going to have the energy to be here today, but I decided to be here because I have this energy and this anger. And if you feel that too, you're not alone. I'm with you. And maybe you feel sad, and that's cool too. But I'm in a spot where I'm just angry at people for holding up this process, a legitimate process for a legitimate elected official, and just having the rules. They just don't think the rules pertain to them. And there's a lot of other anecdotes I could throw in here, but all I can think of is seeing a really angry group of white men just charge into this building and have nothing happen to them, have no consequences, and have it be absolutely in my mind, knowing that if those people were not white, it would look completely different. And just having it be so awful. And growing up, the thing that I'll probably start to piece out on here, so I'm not just ranting like Alex Jones like a maniac here for like the next 10 minutes, is that growing up, I was always told by adults and everybody else, like, what makes the United States different, Brian, is we have a peaceful transition of power. And now I am a 34-year-old man, and I am watching like on my TV as there are violent people trying to take whatever they can because they feel it is their right for whatever reason, whether it's right or not, whether it's correct or not, whether it's real news or fake news. And it's just not what I was taught to believe. And so having this reality check today of, okay, like, we are not all in this nation, and there are these people that want to take it away from you. And that's why I'm angry today. And I think that's where I'll end today.
Okay. That's fair. Thank you for sharing. I do appreciate you bringing that energy, but I also appreciate you bringing your truth, because I know that that's, it's hard to separate all that out, and it's sometimes hard to battle with those feelings, especially when they've been ingrained in you for such a long time. So,
well, and I appreciate y'all's love and support, because I feel like it's someone's crazy uncle right now.
That's okay. That's okay. I would take you as my crazy uncle anytime. Yeah. Marcus.
Yeah.
Sidekick to the one, the only, Brian Roush.
Oh my gosh.
How are you doing?
I am going to say this. Okay, here we go. I'm going to get right into it.
Let's do it.
I'm going to say this. I'm going to say thank you, Brian, right? And thank you, Doug, but thank you, Brian, since you spoke first, because you're using your privilege, your identity to speak on something that does not necessarily directly affect you, but you see the results could be so much different outside of your own identity. And me as a black man, as the black on films in black and white, ooh, that was bad, the black, but as the black, I am representing the black on films in black and white.
Yep.
That is important for me. You know what I'm saying? It's nothing that we had to have a pre-discussion, no pre-recorded meeting. These are just individual thoughts and ideas that these gentlemen had on their own today and came here and used their platform without going like, well, we should do it just because Marcus is on the podcast, or because we don't want to feel awkward or anything like that. It was just because that's genuinely in their heart. And I just want to say thank you for doing that. Here's what I'm going to say. Okay. I'm going to try to collect my thoughts in the best way possible. But here's my feelings toward it. I am not surprised. Okay. Me being, and here is what I love about the world that we live in. Brian said he was taught at an age that, you know, this is why things are so different, that, you know, blah, 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 blah. And for me, excuse me, I've always viewed things in a very different light. Okay. And it's because of my identity, how I was raised, how we're told to move, because of the powers that may be, et cetera, and it's et cetera, et cetera. I'm not surprised by the actions of today. I am not surprised. In fact, I think that a lot of us, we're talking about these things when the protest for Black Lives Matter was happening and George Floyd. And we were saying that, why are we being treated this way? If we were anything else, we wouldn't be treated this way. Okay. Then they were like, that's not true. If anybody destroying property, when the looting starts, the president said, when the looting starts, the shooting starts. So Lord. Today, and I want to say this, I'm not enticing violence, and I'm not saying I wish that anybody got hurt or harmed, but I'm saying that the way that they did not get harmed today, I'm asking that why don't people treat us like that? How they got treated today. Okay. Yep. So I say these statements now, preface that. I'm not prefacing no more because I said what I said and you either gonna listen or you're not. So what I'm saying is, we told people, the president said, when the looting starts, the shooting starts. He was saying people should get a maximum of 10 years, blah, 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 for destruction of
oh my gosh, yeah,
statues that were of these racist men that had terrible histories. And they go to a federal building on federal grounds.
Like the federal building.
The federal building that when I toured in the eighth grade, they told us to keep our hands in our pocket and don't touch anything. Lord. Like they had metal detectors and they strutted their asses in here and they went and put Trump flags inside of the hands of statues. They kicking their feet up on Pelosi's desk. They taking pictures of private documents. They are wrecking the federal building after you told my black ass that we deserve to get shot and you validated violence when we lit a target on fire because of oppression. Today, they march for entitlement. We were marching because we were sick of being oppressed. We are two different breeds. I really want you to understand that. So like, yep, nothing today surprises me at all. And really, I spent 95% of my day laughing. I just spent 95% of my day laughing at the idea. I called my dad and he was in meetings all day, so he didn't even know what was going on.
Oh,
I called my dad and I said, "Dad, are you watching the news?" And he said, "No, what's happening?" I said, "They stormed the Capitol." He said, "No." And I said, "Yes." I watched him click on the news. He said, "Oh my God." And we both just started laughing. And the thing that came out from the laughter, it's sad, but it's true. My dad said, "You know that if that was us, they would have shot our black ass on the street." Not even getting to the Capitol, not stepping foot on the grounds, but if it was us, they would have shot us dead in the street long before we were able to storm a building. They were shooting, busting out glass. They're in the speaker seat screaming, yep, "Trump won," and the president's got the nerve to post, yep, a 1 minute video saying that you are loved and I feel you and thank you to the same motherfuckers that are bashing the place that we are supposed to respect. Colin Kaepernick couldn't get a job, got blackballed, and took a knee to make a point. These motherfuckers marched their ass inside and was trying to burn ballots and had zip ties and weapons with intentions to harm people. So with that, I will say, I'm not surprised. 2020 was a year of, they say you got 2020 vision. If we're going to go to an old pastor bag, 2020 was a year of clear vision. And it was because it revealed and it showed a lot, and it revealed a lot of people, and it exposed a lot of people and what they believe in and how flawed this fucking system is, yes, and how fucked up this world is and how nasty motherfuckers can really be. Mm-hmm. And for those of you that still support in the midst of this, yeah, I don't give a fuck about losing a follower. I don't care about losing a listener. For those of you that still are making excuses for this, go ahead. May love be with you. You know what I'm saying? Because I don't need you supporting me, because I am the opposite of that. And if you're going to support me, the Bible, Revelations 3:15 talks about you're either hot or you're cold. And if you're lukewarm, I will spit you out. You have to pick a side. You cannot be both. And if you love me, you cannot be on that other side. So that is me. I'm not surprised by the day. It sucks that it had to happen, but I'm glad that it revealed itself through the identity of people that don't look like me to the identity of people that don't look like me.
That's beautiful. Yep. Yes.
Yeah.
And that's all I got. That's all I got.
Marcus, again,
how do you feel?
Here's how I feel. First off, thank you for sharing, especially like you did say, you are in the films in black and white, you are the black part of that. So I'm not trying to say you're our black in films in black and white. That'd be a bad place to start. So what I will say is, and I'll say this, I too am like Marcus. I'm not surprised. These people are who we thought they were. And
yep.
for much of this, I'm not surprised or shocked by their behavior. My brain space is a little bit different. I'm outraged that they would take these steps and they would be such sore losers. And then on the other side, what I'm faced with is the explanation to children about it is like, how do you, to Brian's point, like, how do you teach this? Cause Harrison's thing lately is like, if he hears Brittany and I having a discussion, like he hears us say, like the voices get a little bit more tense and a little bit more loud. And he goes, guys, stop arguing.
Oh,
and today we were talking very heatedly about, I said, I cannot believe that this would happen. And he heard me get a little bit more tense and I started to get a little bit more hot and my voice raised. And he goes, Dad, stop arguing. And I said, buddy, I'm not arguing. I'm just really, really, really frustrated and really, really disappointed. And so then we went into this like, hey, you remember that election we talked about? Do you remember about that, like the votes and that thing such happened?
Early age.
And what I tried to say was, I said, like, there are people who are being unkind when they lost. And I said, that was the best way that I can explain it. Mm-hmm. But in actuality, if Harrison were older, I would say they're not being unkind. They are being destructive in what they're doing to the system itself. I'm not upset about physical space being destroyed. I'm upset at the foundational document being like the foundation of it, the principles, the values of it being taken mm-hmm. apart. However, I am going to reserve my outrage if we don't use this for something.
Ooh, tell them, Doug!
Because where I'm at, and what frustrates me is because we do this shit all the time.
Yep.
You know, we have an opportunity, and if you want to be resilient and if you want to grow, sometimes these things need to happen.
Yeah, got to burn that motherfucker down.
You got it. Sometimes
right.
you need to see a group of white supremacists and you need to see a group of people who are deeply misguided in their interpretation of the facts as they've been presented. You need to see them because I think there were people in that building who said they would never come for us.
Oh, yes.
They would never come for us.
Yes.
They would never have the gall to storm the building.
Mr. Yep, Ted Cruz.
Yep. They are getting hot. Yep. They're rabble rousing. But the president would never incite them to come for us. And what the fuck happened? They came for you.
Yep.
So maybe all of that time where you didn't take the danger seriously, maybe you'll take the danger seriously going forward.
Yep.
Because this will happen again.
Yes.
History is a circle. It will happen again. Mm-hmm. What I will be more disappointed with is that when it loops back over again, then I'm going to be angry. Because if we don't learn anything from this is the first time since the War of 1812 that a body other than the federal government has made it into the Capitol building.
Yep.
It was in 1814 that the British burned the Capitol down. And that was in the War of 1812. Been over 150 years at this point in time. So like if in 50 years we're here again and I'm still alive, then I'm going to be pissed. And then I'm going to say like, y'all didn't learn shit.
80-year-old Doug telling them how it is.
This is the person who bathed themselves in like blood and went swimming with sharks and said, nah, they're not going to bite me. And then I'm supposed to feel bad for you when you get bit.
Yep.
I don't. I really don't. I'm sad that it took sacrificing our Constitution for us to get there, but I am not surprised and I'm not disappointed. I'm not angry yet. I'm disappointed, but I'm not angry yet. I'll be angry if we don't learn from the lesson. So that's kind of where I'm at.
There's that stuff. That was beautiful, Doug. That was absolutely beautiful. And Brian, that was just a beautiful moment from the trio. So shout
I mean,
out,
yeah. It feels like we're like three stages of grief.
Here. We really are. Yeah. Like, yeah.
That's what I really enjoy about
that. And
this.
That is the best part of the chemistry about this podcast. And there's one hell of a way.
Oh, for sure.
Season 2. There's a story about the woman who slept with a snake. And it was this person who she slept with a snake every night. And every night the snake would just cuddle up with her, and she thought that that was the sweetest thing ever, and it would just cuddle up with her. But really, in actuality, what the snake was doing was sizing her up. Yep. It was measuring itself to swallow her whole. And that is exactly what was happening. They said, never us. They are us. And they walked right in and said, we don't give a fuck about that.
No.
All that blue lives, back the blue.
Oh my
gosh. That was just strictly to silence Black Lives Matter when it came out and to be a distraction. None of that mattered when they were against you and trying to keep you from the goal that you were trying to fulfill. And it's so fucked up. But Doug, y'all absolutely hit that right on the head. Yeah. I don't know if I have a sound of applause in here, but I don't think I do.
Air horns, applause, it doesn't matter. That's the only applause I need. Yeah.
I mean,
that was great. So it's a disappointing day. We will try to, from now on, provide you with that escapism that you came here for. But it is what it is, and we definitely wanted to make sure we cover it. Now, for those people who are new to the podcast and are maybe just joining us for season two after season one, we play a game called Catch That Quotable, where we each try to stump each other in a quote that we have selected. Now, the leaderboard starts fresh because it's season two.
We go back to zero. Oh.
We all go back to zero. I do believe Brian won last season.
Okay.
That he came rocketing to the top.
Hello.
So since Brian won season one, we are going to let him go first and pick whose quote to use. So Brian, you can go first, or either Marcus or myself can go first. But who would you like to go first for Catch That Quotable, the first one of season two?
All right. You know what? Look, Marcus brought that mask energy. I'm going to have him go first.
There it is.
Marcus, hit us with that quote.
Here we go. Listen.
I really wish people could see Marcus has like an orange ski mask.
You know what?
I'm not kidding.
If you want to see Marcus's orange mask, you should join the Patreon, because all the video episodes are going there. There's a link in there'll be a link on our Facebook. You check that shit out.
You can join it to see the faces I make at Doug and Marcus when they're talking.
Come for the faces, if only for the faces.
But stay for the Roush.
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
Shit. All right, what you got?
Quote. Here we go. Is everybody ready?
Yes. I'm ready.
Hey. I just lost my quote.
Oh, perfect. I've been there.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, nope. I've lost. Oh, no, I'm back. All right, here we go. I'm fine. Fine. You know what fine stands for, don't you? Freaked out, insecure, neurotic, and emotional.
Man.
Once again, for those in the back, I'm fine. Fine. You know what fine stands for, don't you? Freaked out, insecure, neurotic, and emotional.
Oh, man. This is a high school movie. This has got to be a high school movie. I think so.
Oh, man.
I don't know, though. It has that like high school movie vibe to it of like, two best friends, one person just found the other guy dating somebody. She's like, no, I'm fine. And then, you know, this happens.
I guess I was picturing like a rom-com. Well, I guess I could take place in high school, but like a 20s rom-com. Okay. And like someone's like,
all right.
And then someone gets this zinger for the preview.
All right, Marcus, you give us, I'm going to slap that hint button. What do you got?
Okay. Hold on. Give me 1 second.
Okay.
Your hint is going to be Minnie.
Minnie?
Minnie. Minnie is your hint.
Minnie.
Minnie.
I knew that threw you for a loop too.
Oh no. Oh, man. Okay. I have my guess.
All right, go for it, man.
Marcus, is this Purple Rain?
It is not Purple Rain. Can you describe to me how you got that?
So I thought, so in Purple Rain, Prince is in a relationship with a young woman. Okay. And so I thought this could be a conversation on that end. And then you said Minnie, and I was like, maybe he's trying to make some sort of allusion to Minneapolis where Purple Rain is set. So that's how I pieced it all together. So I'm curious to see what it is, but that was my guess.
Okay. Brian Roush.
All right, Brian, what do you got?
Man, is this, I'm not feeling confident. Is this No Strings Attached?
It is not no strings attached. What made you think of what made you think of that?
I'm just on. I don't know. Like, I just got a rom-com vibe from it, and okay. like, I thought of like the Ashton, the most Ashton Kutcher-y, yeah, like, makes sense. I don't know, like Valentine's Day movie. That's where I went.
That's fair.
All right, gentlemen, this movie is the hit Italian Job.
Oh my god!
Oh my god!
And the hint, Minnie, came from Minnie Cooper. Minnie Cooper, that they drove
when they smuggle the gold bullion.
Yes.
Well done. Yes. That's I've not seen that movie in a long time. Well done.
That movie is so solid. My god!
It made me think of it because I rewatched actually. Hobbs and Shaw. Don't ask me why. Rewatched Hobbs and Shaw. Actually, wasn't a terrible movie. It's just one of those, like, you know, this is a good popcorn movie. Rewatched Hobbs and Shaw, and they had a cameo with Jason, with I forgot his name, but the British man,
Statham.
Jason Statham. His Mini Cooper was actually in that movie, and they referenced it. He was like, "Hey, what are you doing with that little car?" And he says, "Oh, that's from an old Italian Job."
Or, oh my gosh!
Oh, so Jesus!
That's incredible.
Was good. Yeah, it was kind of fun because I was like, "Damn, I was there for that." But yeah.
All right. Well done. Good pick.
Thank you.
Marcus, who do you want to go next? Either Brian or you'd like me to go next?
Let's. You know what? I want to go to the first heat. I want to save the best for last. So let's go to the first heat, Douglas.
Oh, okay.
Wagner.
All right. Y'all ready?
You aren't the best, Doug, but he was the winner of last season. So
he was.
Oh, shucks.
All right. What do you got, Brian?
All right. Here we go. Quote, "I have never known anyone who actually believed that I was enough."
Oh, damn.
And one more time for those at home. Oh. "I have never known anyone who actually believed that I was enough."
Jesus. I'm going to tell you off rip, this is some sad shit.
This is an emotional confrontation is what this is.
Who is the white man that says this? It's a white leader.
Or white woman.
No, it's a man.
You think so?
Oh, wait. Yeah, it's a man. It's a man giving a woman a guilt trip. I've never known him.
All right.
He must have, like, did her dirty. And she's like, "Well, why do you treat people like that?" And then he's kind of like, "Oh, shit." Like, it's
Do you think it's a Matthew McConaughey style white man, or do you think it's somebody else?
It's somebody a little bit uglier than Matthew McConaughey, because Matthew McConaughey is like, you know, what's that one where he was the bird straight out the thing? It was like, it was when he was the mama's boy in the house, but then he had to leave. And like, anyway,
okay.
Hint. Smash the hint button.
Yeah. Brian? What's our one word hint?
Pharmaceuticals.
Oh, geez.
You know, this makes me think of that movie where Robin Williams was like this pervert who was like,
"Oh, I think I know this though too." Okay.
Pharmaceuticals.
I guessed first last time, so I'm gonna let Marcus guess first this one.
Okay. Wow. I don't know who's in the pharmaceuticals lately. I don't know, but
that's all right.
Damn, this is a rom-com.
I also think it's a rom-com.
I don't know, so I can't.
That's okay.
I don't know. It's pharmaceuticals.
Pharmaceuticals, yes.
Okay, I don't know. I want to go.
All right, I have my guess.
Okay, yeah, you guess.
Brian, is this No Strings Attached?
It is not.
It is. Is this one flew over the cuckoo's nest?
It is not. It is. I pulled this out. I enjoy this movie. "Love and Other Drugs." This line is given by Jake Gyllenhaal, which this is why I was cracking my shit up. So I was like,
at the Marcus generic white man comment.
Like, he is right on the money it's Jake Gyllenhaal talking to Anne Hathaway.
There it is.
So there you go.
All right. Good pick. All right,
Doug.
Y'all ready for me?
Let's get it.
The mind is a fragile thing. Takes only the slightest tap to tip it in the wrong direction.
Oh, fuck, wait. Oh, I thought this was...
The mind is a fragile thing. Takes only the slightest tap to tip it in the wrong direction.
Okay, there we go. The mind is a fragile thing. and it only takes. It sounds like the Matrix.
But it's not. It does. The Matrix. It does, man. It definitely has this vibe of like. It's meta, right?
Yeah. Like, but I feel like the way that he read it, it's like somebody fucking with him. So like when he said it takes one tap, it's like he literally tapped.
Right.
It. So it was like the mind is a little thing and it takes like a tap. Like, you know? Like
we both know the delivery and like, yeah. What is happening with
yeah,
the yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Dog, I'm smashing that hint.
Your one word hint is psychic.
The mind is a, oh my god.
All right. I'm
I know this movie. I know this movie.
You're gonna be so mad.
I'm gonna go for it. Is this Glass?
Brian, it is not Glass. It's a good guess though. It is not Glass.
All right.
It's not Taylor. It takes one thing to tap it. Shit. I know this movie, and it's really making me think of that one with Hugh Jackman and when they were the mentalist.
The Prestige.
The Prestige, yes.
Oh,
that one.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Make me think of that one. It only takes one thing to tap it. Okay. I'm just gonna say the Prestige, but it's not the Prestige.
It is not the Prestige.
What is it, Doug?
This is a quote said by the one Charles Xavier in Dark Phoenix.
You watched Dark Phoenix.
I finally watched Dark Phoenix. And I have to say, New Mutants is worse.
Oh, no. New Mutants is
so much worse.
It is. No. It's bad.
Oh, my gosh.
Because not to get into Dark Phoenix too much, but Dark Phoenix for like 2/3 of that movie, up until the blonde woman gets really, really involved, there's something like compelling there. It's just the third act is dog shit, and I didn't enjoy the majority of New Mutants. So anyway, but yes, I finally watched Dark Phoenix.
Damn.
Yeah. There you go. There you go.
Wow. Yeah.
Bring it in.
We all stumped each other. Congrats, everybody.
Just like off on a zero.
It wouldn't be an episode of Films in Black and White if we all got it wrong. Like it just it wouldn't be something about it that just that wouldn't should, be that
we
way.
We had Love and Other Drugs, X-Men Dark Phoenix, and then the Italian Job.
Yeah, we were across the gambit for sure.
Yeah. Okay. We're not one-sided over here. Welcome to season 2, bitch.
Yeah. That sounds like a good weekend lineup. It's really true.
Hey, actually, that's not bad.
Yeah.
I mean,
So we have some news though to get into, and since we last spoke, there have been a lot of announcements that have come out of Hollywood.
Oh my gosh.
And this is a news episode, so we're going to break those down for you. But I would like Brian to use some of that energy and kick us off with his first piece of news. So, Brian, what do you got?
All right, I put everything in a Google Doc because
this
is season 2.
Look at you, season 2, breaking out the tech.
So that's what we're looking at here. I'm going to lead with what is absolutely just gobsmacking me right now. So we're going to talk about The Office and Peacock.
That was one of mine.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. All right. Well, then feel free to jump in. Yeah. Because The Ringer, TheRinger.com read an article talking about like Peacock and The Office paywall. And I was like, what exactly is happening here? So just by the numbers, my news piece, my hard news is that Peacock to date has had 26 million signups and subscriptions, which is more than a lot of analysts expected. 26 million signups is a lot. For comparison, HBO Max in mid-December had just 12.6 million. So like, it's not a number to like, you know,
not to be disappointed at all.
Dismiss. Right. Now, I wonder what happened with Wonder Woman, but you got to imagine a lot of those people are dropping it. But in any case, so it's a sizable amount. And that was the piece I wanted to bring. But the big thing I wanted to point out was this article goes into detail how the entire Peacock streaming service, even down to like how they're advertising it for subscription models, it's all based on The Office. Yeah. And it is blowing my mind. So I kid you not, if you go to peacocktv.com/plans/office, you can do this. It is January 6th, 2021. they list it out by how much Office you can watch. Like, that is the subscription model. It's like going to Netflix and being like, how much Stranger Things do you want to watch? Just really highlighting the fact that Peacock is kind of in this rut where they don't have a lot of original programming. Trying to compete with these other services. And I kid you not, the first plan is like, hey, you can watch seasons 1 and 2 of The Office for free with ads.
Yeah.
There's a Peacock Premium, and that gets you access to all The Office for $5. Yeah. And you get never-before-seen footage. Now, boy, howdy, let me tell you about Peacock Premium Plus.
Yeah.
You get all of The Office without ads. So essentially, Peacock is marketing this as how much, like, do you want Office without ads? Then pay us $10. That's pretty much their pricing model. I think that's wild. That's my news.
Yeah, that's
Marcus and Doug. What do y'all think?
Brian, that's insane. And when you click on it, so I'm on it right now on my phone. When you click on it and you like break down like show plan details, it gets even more in the Office weeds. So like when you click on Peacock Premium Plus and you say show plan details, it's every episode of The Office, The Office Zen 24/7 channel, and The Office Extended Cuts. And the plus is watch select titles off. Oh, I thought that said watch select titles of The Office off and on offline mode. That's amazing. Not what it said. But still, like, that's a. I mean, they're really going all in The Office. Yes. And don't get me wrong, like, that show's enjoyable, but I don't. That's not the reason why I'm gonna get it. Like, that's like saying, that's like HBO Max saying, like, how much Friends do you want to watch? Like,
not that damn much. I'll tell you that. I don't want to watch. Listen, here's. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Doug.
I don't have anything else. You go right ahead,
Marcus.
I think that it's bullshit that you. I saw this right, and it was like $9.99 for the premium, I do believe. Right?
Yeah.
This is kind of how OnlyFans works. Don't ask me how I know, just research purposes. But like, this is kind of how OnlyFans works.
There's no shame
here. It's like, and it's a weird thing that like the more you want to see, the more you pay. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's like any porn site, and Peacock Premium just sounds like a nasty porn site that you're like using The Office to like wear this silk red robe, and you're just like, guess what's underneath the robe for like $12.99? Like, I'll show you a titty. Like, come on now. Like, The Office is a good show.
Welcome to the Jim Halpert OnlyFans.
Yeah,
pretty much.
So of all the people you could name,
I was gonna go Steve Carell with your OnlyFans. Like, he's just like Steve Carell. We have a naked Steve Carell version of The Office.
And
like,
somebody wants to see that. I'm sure. We're not.
It's very possible.
We don't kink shame here at Films in Black and White. We don't kink shame at all.
No, if that's your jam, that's great.
That's cool. But I just think in seriousness, it is bullshit that you're charging. Like, you don't have any original I know that you have the new Saved by the Bell TV show.
Yep.
I know they're trying to push that. I get what you're trying to do, but you're really using The Office. That's like Disney using, like, they didn't even do that for any of their shows, and Disney offers you literally everything.
It's like, hey, watch Disney Plus and you get The Mandalorian behind the scenes for you would never think that.
I don't think that's.
I mean, they're taking the DVD approach to selling their premium features.
Yes.
I mean, that's why it was like the difference between a DVD and a Blu-ray was often the Blu-ray came with a second bonus disc that had all the bonus features that, to be honest with you, I know very few people outside myself and a handful of others who really like popped in and said, like, let me watch the bonus features. Like most of the people I knew said, the DVD's fine. I have a Blu-ray player that upscales it, so it doesn't matter. So that's all it is. And there are select titles like the Dark Knight trilogy where you would want the bonus features. But it seems like Peacock's model is like, okay, people will buy a $10 more Blu-ray for bonus features. Let's do that with The Office. Like, it just, it seems like such a poor business model.
Well, you're feeding off of people's like nostalgia. What happens when I watch all this shit? It was like they, to kind of wrap it up my point, they sat in a bush and they watched how much people loved it on Netflix, and they were like, write that down. They really love it over there.
Yeah.
And then when it was leaving, it was almost like doomsday for a lot of people. Like, hey, the day that The Office leaves Netflix and it's never going to be on there again. And they really just like, this is, that price is for people who have, it's not for new people that are interested in The Office. That price is for the people who have watched The Office at least 100 times.
And who want to watch it 24/7. Like, who will sign up for that? Who will have that 24/7 button clicked and they're just watching it all the time? And look, these people can come at me if they want to. The Office is not a good show across the board, one to season to the last one. It's good. It's enjoyable, but you got to remember it's in 3-season bundles. Jim and Pam have issues. Jim and Pam get together. Jim applies to be regional manager. He doesn't get it. New season. These two people fall in love. These two people get together. Jim applies to be regional manager. Doesn't get it. That's through season 6. Season 7. Like, it, until they introduced like Will Ferrell and those other characters coming in as the new regional manager, that's they had to do it or the show would have died off. That's fine. Come at me if you want to, but that's how I feel about The Office. I'm not saying I don't enjoy it, and I'm not saying it's not funny. There are funny elements. It's just not something you should have on at all times.
So what's funny about that, Marcus mentioned the Zen channel, and in this Ringer piece, the Zen channel is literally like they took all the background sound from an Office episode, and you can just, it's an hour of it or something like
that. What the fuck?
And it you can pretend you're in an office.
Oh, hell no. Just go to work.
Right?
What the fuck are you talking about?
People without jobs who want to know what working in an office is like.
I there's part of me that gets it because it's like, I'm lonely and I don't have an office. I'm remote working. But on the other hand, I'm like, are you all so desperate for content? Like, there was just some marketing person that was like, hey, what if we took the most boring background noises and we made that content?
I could tell you an easy solution for free. Go get yourself a goddamn job. Go get a job.
Yes.
You can hear all of these sounds much as you would like to without paying a premium Peacock subscription.
Yeah. Hey, like, everybody, Target Corporate's hiring. Go work there. It's the same goddamn thing.
Right.
Or go listen to some good lo-fi beats or something. Like, I promise there is better YouTube channels, basic YouTube channels for you that would provide that ambient.
Imagine somebody falling asleep to Zen tunes from The Office. You freak.
Oh, you guys. That
I love The Office. I will put this out there. I disagree with Doug. I think that's fine. You can disagree. Top 3 comedy. I think it's easily one of the best shows I've ever seen. I've rewatched it 3 times. Like, even that weird season 8 with James Spader, I love it.
James Spader season.
I'm weird. I know a lot of people don't like that season. And I think what I'll start wrapping up here with is, like, The Office had such a stranglehold on Netflix, and people just kept it on in the background all the time. I guess so. In the article, it points out, at 1.4% of all streaming on Netflix was just The Office.
Oh,
like,
my God.
Which is just bonkers.
Dude, that's insane.
With how much money they pull in and everything they greenlight. So, I mean, maybe Peacock knows something we don't. I don't know, but
I hope so.
Peacock know shit.
I hope so.
So my last thing here, as I'm looking at the pricing plan, there's an asterisk, by the way, where it says premium without ads. So I looked at it. So it says, due to some streaming rates, a small amount of programming will still contain ads. So you're still paying.
It's like Hulu. It's like when Hulu did Hulu Premium and they still like, look, we can't do all, we can't get rid of all the ads, but we will take it from 3 down to 1.
Right.
Just shut up about it.
So no, like it's still very possible you have ads. So that's one thing I just wanted to point out. Marcus, you said you wanted to talk about this too. Well, did we cover what you wanted to cover too?
You absolutely did.
All right.
That was it. So
Marcus, why don't you just kick us off with your next piece, with your piece?
Yes.
All right. So here's my thing about DC. I'm winging it. I ain't reading shit. Listen.
Do it.
So it's a combination of things that was happening here. Uh-oh. Okay.
Oh, I know.
First, we heard Ray Fisher say that he was not making another movie underneath the current president of DC Films. And his name is in my notes. And I forgot what it was. I forgot what his name is. But as
you keep going, I'll look it up.
Hamada?
Yes, I think that was it, actually.
Yeah, Hamada.
No worries, you're right.
He said that he wasn't making another film under that helm, with him under helm. DC then went and gave Hamada an extension in his contract to 2023, I do believe.
Yeah.
So that kind of said a lot. But then news came out today that you know, it was originally intended for Cyborg to be written into the new Flash movie. It's said now that he is no longer written in that film and is going to be said replaced with another character, which possibly will be Gal Gadot. Because in turn to that, it is said that I'm kind of giving all my news at once, which
that's
is fine.
Okay,
but it's fine.
It said that moving forward, DC is only going to be operating with two Batman in two separate universes.
Oh my gosh, yep.
One being Keaton, Michael Keaton, the OG Batman, and the other being Robert Pattinson and not Ben Affleck. So the character that they're going to replace Cyborg with has to be Gal Gadot, because that is the only other person that that makes sense with, because they haven't worked out anything with Henry Cavill to return as Superman.
Wow.
So all of that to say, Ray Fisher's out. They're not going to recast him. They're not going to redo anything of that nature. They are just, I guess they're after this Snyder series, Justice League cut is done. That's pretty much it for Ray Fisher, and that's pretty much it for that Snyderverse for the most part.
Yeah, that's that. You know, that just real quick, like, that's shitty. Like, he spoke his mind and was speaking up about some really just crooked and nasty stuff that they were doing over there, like the with DC Films and Geoff Johns and others, and Josh Whedon and everybody. And it just it sucks that he's being written out of, and essentially, and hopefully he still finds work. Obviously his career as an actor isn't over, but this is a great way to have a really long career, is to be involved with stuff like this. I mean, look at Robert Downey Jr. He had something for 10 years as one character. This could have been something he came back to time and time again and was a consistent paycheck. So, man, that sucks. Like, just to you speak your mind and try to stand up for yourself and stand up for other people, and you just kind of get written out. And that's just That's very soap opery. Like, he fell down an elevator shaft and now he doesn't exist anymore. Like, that's just a shitty thing to do.
I guess I just don't understand, if you're at WB and you see all of this playing out. Like, the thing about this is that for those that don't know, I mean, Ray Fisher has had many instances where he's talked about, like, just not, like, abusive conditions when he was filming Justice League. Gal Gadot has even mentioned that things weren't great. And even having, help me out, who plays Aquaman? Jason Momoa. Momoa supports Ray Fisher in talking about how he was treated on the Justice League set with Joss Whedon.
Yeah.
And then Ray Fisher, in that Forbes article, I believe, was talking about just how awful it was. There was a whole hubbub with that. And basically putting these pieces together of Hamada being this enabler with Geoff Johns and things like that. And I just think it's really disappointing, and it didn't need to get to this, but like, it got to this point because WB didn't do what they needed to do. They could have fixed this, and it's really disappointing.
Well, and even the stuff with Patty Jenkins coming out and saying, like, they had to go to war over the final scene in the first Wonder Woman.
Oh my gosh.
Like, even that, like, the studio has been overly involved. I mean, it sounds like people who are just micromanaging the hell out of this universe, trying to do something super, super specific,
right?
All the while not being kind or being helpful or being collaborative about it, essentially just being a group of assholes being like, you will make it our way. Like, it's just, it seems really, again, really shitty. So
it feels like DC is trying to, like, to the thing with Patty Jenkins. I mean, it was even said for Wonder Woman 3 that has been greenlit. Geoff Johns has had a big part in writing that. And in the article, it was kind of said, like, we'll see what happens. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, we don't know, but I feel like DC is operating like, this is how Kevin Feige does it over there at the Marvel Universe, so you should just listen to us. And I feel like that is not what is happening. Like, they are not the ones, like, it is not one person making all these decisions. I'm sure that he has an idea, and he is the one maybe to keep the glue for a connected universe, but you can't have too many hands in the pot, and you can't have too many hands in the pot that is, okay, now both of y'all are scaring the hell out of me, because both of y'all looked up at your ceilings at two different times. And
we didn't mean to distract. I thought I heard like a wolf noise coming from upstairs.
I heard like a tinkling in my vent, and I was like,
you're fine.
All right. I'm so sorry, Marcus.
I thought a coyote walked in the back door. So that's what I thought happened to
me. This is how horror movies start off, because this is exactly how, and you know what would happen? I would just close my laptop. I would just,
this is it. I'm walking away.
Not doing it. Thank you. Appreciate that. But yeah, I just feel like they are, operating in this way of what they feel like it should be, and that's why they can't get nothing fucking done. So
yeah, agreed.
I guess you already closed it out well. I guess what I just don't get is like they just didn't do their homework. They didn't fix this. And I also feel like it's not that hard to be like, hey, by the way, Joss Whedon sucked on this and we're probably not going to work with him again. Yeah. And you could make amends and call it a day. Like,
all you have to do, and you don't even have to do it publicly. All you have to do is privately collect everybody who was on the first Justice League and say like, hey, sorry, he was an ass and we didn't figure that out soon enough. We're really sorry. Hopefully we can still work with you. We understand if you don't want to be around us anymore.
Yeah.
Like, that's all you have to say.
Maybe. I don't even know. Maybe if that's enough. Sometimes you got to get that public apology. Because
that's true.
If you're tolerating for somebody for so long, there is a point that it's just as much your fault, too.
Yes. You know what I mean? Oh, yeah.
Like,
hey,
you can. Yes. We can toss. We know Josh Whedon's a nasty fuck because of his past. But like, it's so easy to kind of. Throw the baby out with the bathwater. And it's just like, it's so easy to do that.
Yes. But
instead of taking accountability.
Well, today's a great example.
Yeah, right. Exactly. But like, we can blame it on one person, but really that one person was not the one that was storming the fucking, you know what I mean? So that's kind of how my mind operates, at least.
For sure.
No, I'm with you, man.
Completely agree. My piece of news, what I have for everybody is, kind of similar, but a little bit different in terms of casting news. So Zack Snyder obviously has been very famous for his role with, the Justice League and bringing that back and getting his own version of that in a 5-part series on HBO Max. But believe it or not, he also has a Netflix movie that is scheduled to come out where he is doing Army of Darkness. And it's going to be similar to the Army of Darkness that has come out in the past, but they're rebooting it with people like Dave Bautista and some others. But one original person that was originally cast was Chris D'Elia, the comedian. Now, for those of you that don't know, Chris D'Elia, I think almost a year ago at this point in time, came out that he had been like getting into trouble with his appetite for younger women, like, let me put it that way. But to be more specific, there had been some allegations that maybe he was engaging in illicit behavior with underage girls. And so basically it caught up to him really, really fast, and he got canceled, justifiably so, pretty quickly. And they just recently filled his spot on the Army of the Dead movie that's scheduled to come out with Tig Notaro. So finally there's a replacement. So what's really exciting is Tig Notaro is transgender, and she's a comedian, and this is I think her first major movie, and so she's really excited about getting an opportunity to play in her first major role. They did an interview with her, and she said, like, it's really hard for me to not lose sight of the fact that, like, I'm so caught up that I actually get to be in a movie, that like it's hard for me not to be, cause she's a lead. So she's one of like the 5 leads in the movie, which is really, really exciting. So anyway, that is my roundabout news that the Army of Darkness movie is progressing forward. And now with a replacement for Chris D'Elia's character, with Tig Notaro.
So that's nasty fuck, Chris, stop doing dumbass shit and stop doing nasty shit.
Just don't do that.
And at one point in time, what's really funny, at one point in time, USD, like in my role at work, we thought about bringing him to campus as a comedian. Really glad we didn't do that.
Glad we didn't do that. Shout out to the USD. Go yo.
Good job. Hey, go yo. Yep.
Yeah, Chris, you're a nasty fuck.
Yeah. Brian, what else you got?
Listen, 2021, I'm calling out all you nasty fuckers.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yep.
And I'm calling out all you nasty in every sense of the word. If it's attitudes, if it's how you treat people. And if I'm a nasty fuck, then you call me out on my shit too. Yeah. But also, I'm calling you motherfuckers out because I've had enough. I've had enough. I'm no longer tolerating this shit. Sorry, Brian.
No, are you kidding? No, that's that is something important that needs to be said. Like, that's never okay. Like, I feel like it's really important to say, out loud too. And I also want to say, like, Tig is fantastic.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Having her there, I think, is going to be just such a fun addition to the film. Mm-hmm. And for Chris, like, just that's scum. You don't do that. And gross, don't follow his lead. And I hopefully he fades into obscurity. So,
yeah, absolutely.
All right. But for news, the thing I wanted to talk about, because I hold on to things, is IGN published an article earlier this week talking about how Fox was legitimately working on a Fantastic Four versus X-Men movie. And this comes from the Happy, Sad, Confused podcast. IGN was the one that just put it into words.
Sure.
And so Paul Greengrass is a director. He did Bourne Supremacy.
Yep.
And he was in talks to direct this film. And it just sounds bonkers the more you read about it. And it's like almost like you have an 8-year-old telling you about like what they want to see in a movie.
Playing with action figures in the living room.
Pretty much, like every sentence just gets a little bit more weird. So the quote was basically like, it starts off with Fantastic Four and X-Men, but it's gonna borrow like the plot of the Civil War comic books, not the Civil War Marvel movie. And then Daredevil shows up, and then Deadpool shows up. So like, and then they would have a civil war, I guess. I don't really know.
They'll have a civil war.
I don't know. So this was back in 2011 is when they wanted to do this, by the way. So this was before like Days of Future Past, before like the Marvel Civil War, and everything like that.
That's insane.
Yeah, so Greengrass basically confirmed that they were trying to do it. And really the only commentary I wanted to put on here was like, Fox had no idea what they were doing. They were just like, oh, well, we can't get the Avengers for this cool idea.
So who could we have fight that we own? Like,
we've got Daredevil and Deadpool. Do it.
Yeah, right? Like, just throwing stuff at the wall, not understanding.
Did they say, was it going to be a new Fantastic Four, or was it going to be like a group? Was it going to be the ones from the first two?
It's unclear. So it's 2011. Man. So if I had to give this a shot, this would have been before the Fantastic cast.
Oh, yeah. Before the box cast.
Yes. Yep. There you go. I try so hard every time to pronounce it, and everyone always looks at me super weird. Like, it's just Fantastic Four, Brian. Like,
you're no, that four is in the middle of the word fantastic. Yes. That's
there's
not
a
how
four
that,
in yep. the word. I'm gonna pronounce four, the letter. Four-stick.
Yeah, that's how it's written.
That is the art speaking. in any case, but yeah, essentially they just wanted to use all these characters they owned, it would have been bonkers. So in any case, that's what Fox was trying to do before they got bought.
Hey, good job.
Interesting fact I learned. Do you know why the Marvel Cinematic Universe was created?
No.
Tell me, Marcus.
It was created to sell more action figures. So what happened was, Brian, you know about this?
No, this makes sense. No,
what happened was Marvel was in the shitter. They couldn't make any money off of their movies. So therefore they couldn't sell any action figures. So they were in the whole bad, but they had sold all of their rights to their movie characters over to, you know, Fox and Sony, and they couldn't do anything.
Oh yeah, back in the 90s.
I'm
with you now.
Yeah.
So then they fast forward, they ended up taking these characters that people really didn't know, Captain America, Hawkeye, Iron Man, all these people, and showing them the kids and asked them who would you think would be a badass action figure. They all picked Iron Man. So all of them said Iron Man was cool. Then they went and made the Iron Man movie with Robert Downey Jr. and Jon Favreau. And it was apparently like a cheap movie to make. It was a cheap movie to make. They damn near quadrupled the amount of money that they were making. Didn't really sell a lot of action figures still, but the movie did so well that they then started establishing this Marvel Cinematic Universe. That made me think of that because when you said that they threw in the characters that they own, imagine that movie, X-Men, Fantastic Four, Deadpool, and Daredevil Those are characters that they own that they just had to do something with.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
So they had just to keep making movies.
That's
crazy.
Let's put them in there. Yeah. Huh. So I thought that was crazy.
Man, that also tells me that deal of like, again, it tells me that the like the Sony Disney deal.
Oh, yeah.
It tells me that there's a lot more layers that like, we're paying attention to the movie part of it, but there's a lot more to that. That's much, much more.
Oh yeah.
That'll last a lot longer than just the movie, if you know what I mean. So
my gosh,
doesn't hit like it used to. I can tell you that.
Absolutely not.
Well, and just to bump Marcus too, if people are interested, I'm going to look up the official title, but there's a giant Marvel like omnibus of the history of the company. I own it and I'm going to Google it here really, really quick. And in any case, basically it talks about this like from the 90s. Yeah. Marvel Chronicle, a year by year history. And what Marcus talks about is in that book.
That's
talking
crazy.
About what the company went through in the 90s, right. And they had to sell all these characters to avoid bankruptcy, which is why they got separated all these companies. So if you didn't know that, like Marcus is dropping knowledge for y'all to impress your friends with.
And
it's also a really good coffee table book, by the way. Marvel Chronicle, a year by year history. The art's also fun and you get to learn
That's super cool.
And it explains, and before we go to Doug, it explains a lot, if you pay attention to these kind of things, why Marvel is currently trying to buy back all of their rights and stuff. Because now they can afford to do it because Disney is fucking Disney. You know what I mean?
And so
they can afford to buy back these products, except for those ones that are keeping a tight leash, which is why we get that Sony. That shared character space with Spider-Man, Tom Holland, and Morbius, and
stuff.
All of that kind of stuff is why we get that. Wow. So it's really a good read if you care about that kind of stuff.
That's enough. That's super cool, though. I'm gonna have to check that out. That's super cool.
Yeah. So there it is. What's up, Doug?
The next piece of news I have is related to movie theaters and the coronavirus. So two pieces of news related to that. Because believe it or not, although all the news related to COVID is positive with a rollout of the vaccine, people are still hurting because many theaters are still closed. Yep. So first off, Regal Cinemas has announced that it expects that it'll be able to reopen its theaters in New York and LA sometime in March of 2021. Now they are maybe a smidgen over anxious and over realistic with that, just because we're not really seeing a whole lot of improvement in California, and I don't have the latest report on how New York is doing, but it seems like this is such a fluid situation that it seems really dangerous to give any firm report on plans for that, for any type of opening at that point in time. On the other side, so AMC, I've reported on this before, but AMC has signed some deals with some studios that says that essentially 17 days after a day movie premieres in their theaters, it can go to video on demand. And I've reported on that. I think it was Universal was the last one that they signed a big deal with. But recently, before the holiday season, they announced that they were trying to raise $750 million, essentially kind of like wait out the pandemic. They basically said, hey, if we're going to make it, this is what the dollar figure is that we think we're going to need in order to make it to survive. They announced today, you know, they're reporting on, I think it's like the first few weeks of that campaign being officially live. And they announced that they have raised $203 million of that $750 million goal. Now, there were no details that I could find as far as how they did that, whether that was selling more shares of their stock or whether that was just selling off properties that maybe weren't doing well even before COVID. But as of right now, that's kind of how they're doing in trying to get themselves sort of some cushion as they navigate the remainder of the pandemic, however the hell long that's going to be. That's kind of how theaters are doing. From a financial standpoint, I mean, I'm glad for Regal thinks that they can announce. I think they're going to end up reaching the harsh reality that they can't, or again, like I said, they shouldn't be too firm. Mm-hmm. But it's exciting.
And really quick for numbers, how much do they need?
They felt so. AMC felt that they needed $750 million.
That's what I thought. And they got two.
They got $203 million.
Oh man!
They made it a third of the way.
in that's the first, a lot of hundred millions to get to still.
And that's I think it's relatively, they said they were very optimistic about that. They're like,
yeah,
we haven't been trying to raise these funds for long, but we're very optimistic that in such a short period of time people have responded. We're not out of the woods yet, but we're really excited with what the response has been thus far. So yeah, I mean, I'm glad they're doing what they can. I hope that they can stay open and that we don't have this like mass of, like, especially in rural communities like, yep, you know, South Dakota, North Dakota, and others, where AMCs are sort of your big theaters where you get a really, yep, big screen and the whole experience, the whole nine. Mm-hmm. I hope that they don't go out of business, because for some that's their only option. But
oh yeah,
it seems to me that if they're gonna have to cut anything, it's gonna be, you know, keep all our big city stuff open and close all our smaller stuff. So, but
I want to add a point.
Yes. Yeah.
That I thought was interesting.
Yes.
Wonder Woman box office, Wonder Woman 1984.
Yes.
$5.5 million domestically and $118 million globally.
Yes. Yeah. They're getting very close to that $200 million mark.
Right. Yep. So I think we're going to be okay. I hate to be too optimistic.
Yeah.
A lot
of people are leaning on the vaccine and that the vaccine is, mm-hmm, out. And, you know, you'll start hopefully, because even Dr. Fauci today in a report I was listening to was like, he was like hoping at the end of the summer, things would be kind of boosting back to a normal.
Right.
And so I get why they would say March, because they're hoping that in March people are starting to get the vaccine and can come back to movie theaters, and that'll be the first place that people go. But I wanted to put that Wonder Woman number out there, because it answered two different questions of, can we do, yeah, both? And the answer is yes.
Yes.
And it says that there are people that are watching in a theater during a pandemic. So, mm-hmm, what are they going to do when they can actually go in? You know what, right, I'm saying? Just put that, yeah, out there.
Yeah. Yeah. They're a long way from being able to be back to 100% maximum right, occupancy. I mean, they're going to still have to operate. I mean, you got to figure, even if they open in New York and LA, they're going to be at 25%, and then things will get a little better, and then maybe it'll be 50, then it'll go back down to 30 for a little bit, and it'll kind of be this roller coaster of what their occupancy loads can be for those spaces based on, yeah, safety. But I mean, you'd got to think that at some point in time they'll be able to do it. But it's, so it'll be interesting to see, especially as more of this happens, because, you know, there's a full slate of Warner Brothers movies that are scheduled to come out,
right,
over the course of the next few months,
yeah,
right, that are gonna go into a theater where it's open. So I, yes, think we're gonna see, like Marcus said, we are gonna start to see some maybe more promising box office numbers, we hope.
Man, I'm torn, because, like, on one hand, like, I don't want movie theaters to go away, I like theaters,
yeah.
On the other hand, like, I also know AMC is like, they're a multi-million dollar corporation. Oh,
yeah. Staple. Yeah.
Like, so it's wild to me they're asking for investors to help them, like, basically get to the other side of this.
Yeah.
Which, on one hand, like, I get it. You didn't get any relief from, mm-hmm, like, the last government bill. Nope. That,
yeah,
they passed,
were ineligible,
the relief
for
bill.
Yeah.
Which is such an oversight. Obviously, I'm gonna think that. I love movies and movie theaters. I do hope they make it. I know they're a chain, and I know that, like, yeah, a lot of people, some people are like, ugh, an AMC theater, like, that's a chain or whatever, but I feel like having more theaters is better than not. So I do wish, sure, them the best, and hope they can get to a place where they're not at least closing places.
Yeah, for sure, for sure, for sure. Marcus, any news that you have left to report?
I think my last one is going to be a little bit sad, a little somber.
Okay.
After 20 years, the PBS show Caillou has been canceled.
Oh,
what?
Thank
God.
They came
for Caillou, huh?
They came. Yeah, he's. They came for Caillou. Yeah. 20 years. I mean, that show is now done. PBS announced that Caillou is officially done on the network after nearly two decades of episodes. Caillou is no more. And it says parents everywhere are celebrating.
as a parent, not to say that there aren't shows that my children love and I'm glad they love them, but there are, yeah, some shows where I'm like, why the fuck do you like this? And why do I have to listen to it? So
guy was always, he was a bad little motherfucker.
He's a
but
bald kid.
Yeah. He's extremely bald. Yeah, I mean, that's all it's really saying is that PBS, you know, they canceled Caillou after 20 years. So if you like that show and a bald headed kid that used to be acting up and need an ass whooping, I'm sorry, I don't know what to tell you.
Oh man,
I mean, oh my god, it took a turn.
All right. Welcome to Parenting Advice with Marcus Destin.
From the one motherfucker
from who doesn't have any children.
Don't do that to your kid. But I mean, I don't even know.
Hands are not for hitting, Marcus.
Right, because Brian slid in there. Like,
I don't even. I'm a parent, and I don't know the show at all.
Oh, thank God, I don't know this show.
You're not missing anything. Okay. Oh, you don't know the show either?
No, I know.
I used to watch this growing up, which is funny. Yeah,
that's crazy. No, I don't know this show at all. This is not. I mean, I know. You know, Dragons Rescue Riders on Netflix, like the back of my hand. Like, I can tell you all the names of the stupid dragons, but I don't know Caillou at all.
Damn. I mean, I think this is, I'll just launch into some, I'm going to hijack this a little bit, Marcus, and I'll come back full circle. Yeah. One of the things that's weird about having kids with streaming is like, so for PBS, they had commercials or like, they even had at least segments between shows like, my four-year-old, I've talked about him before, Liam, like he has never had a reality where he would have to wait like to watch a commercial for a show.
Yeah.
You want to watch Spider-Man? Here you go. Here's three of them in a row, kid. You want to watch PJ Masks? Sure. No commercials. Whenever you want. So like trying to like reconcile all that with this news of having this beloved show. Apparently some people hated this show. I Googled it when you were talking about it, and some people did not like this show.
He was bad. He was a bad kid.
He was getting into trouble.
It was like it was a bad example for like your kid to be on a temper tantrum, and then the parents were very like,
okay.
Yeah, it was very weird. Yeah, it was very weird.
Caillou found his crayon and colored the walls, and his mom was mad. Like, that was an episode.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm learning a lot.
That's good.
PBS. I miss PBS. I love PBS and appreciate it growing up because, you know, Dragon Tales, Caillou, you know, Between the Lions, Cyber Chase. Like, these were shows that I watched because we were broke growing up. And so, like, like, public, you know, that was the thing to go to. Even those, the British show, even watching like the British shows.
The mysteries on Friday nights and stuff. My parents loved that stuff.
That was just, you know, that was just life growing up and that was the norm. But like Brian said, there is no commercials. You can just pay not to get those. You know what I'm saying? And boom, there it is.
And I'm pretty sure the PBS app has something similar now too. Like, it's just how we consume media now. Yeah. Like, it's just, it's wild to me.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, that's all I got.
Brian, what else do you have? Anything left that you have to report on?
The only other thing I wanted to talk about was, so you're here for the escapism. Well, good boy, howdy, do I have some for you. Star Wars, The High Republic. Yeah. It is launching. We are going to a galaxy far, far away, a very long time ago, by the way. So essentially, if you don't know, The High Republic is a new blitz of media coming from Disney, Lucasfilm, and it's essentially going to be set 200 years before The Phantom Menace. I'm not going to take a lot of time on it, but it's starting and I'm excited about it because they're going to a time period we haven't really explored. I think there's like two video games that have explored this area far back, and so there's going to be books, graphic novels, manga. There's a lot going on here. So StarWars.com has an entire landing page for The High Republic. They're going to be doing adult focused books, like middle school books and elementary books, which I think is really cool because it's so accessible for people to like learn about Star Wars and get involved with it. And I'm excited for it. So I'm just excited to explore a new corner of Star Wars and just kind of also see some flourish. Like, even some of the visuals that they have, they've got people with two sabers with cross guards. What? Who does that? High Republic people do.
High Republic people do.
So there you go. That's my only news. I'm amped for it. Yeah. So I'm excited.
I blame Brian for my new Star Wars fever that I have. But
oh, like, I love it.
Yeah, he caught it bad.
I caught it bad. I really realized how much I love Star Wars because of Brian really like hyping it up and being like, no, it's much deeper than just lightsabers. And I was like, you know what? It is much deeper than
honestly, it makes me happy because Star Wars can be so many things to so many people.
That's true.
And like we can all think something is rad about it and like get different things from it. I also need to point out to our listeners, I love it so much because Marcus is at the point where he's sending me like TikToks at like 10 p.m. be like, yo, check this out. And he's talking to me about Jedi. I don't even know their names, like from the prequels. And it just makes my heart so happy because like now I'm learning. Like I'm learning from Marcus's love. Like it's just, it's a good time.
Super cool.
For those of you that don't know, in 2021, I am a Mace Windu advocate.
Yes.
So I am working, and because I know you motherfuckers listen to this podcast, not the listeners, but I'm talking about the people up top, the industry people. Y'all are listening to this podcast.
Kathleen Kennedy, okay? You listen.
Hey, we know that you're listening because you keep taking our ideas and move on them. Okay? You move on them. We're like 3 for 3 on this fucking podcast. Yeah. And we were the first to say fuck Josh Whedon. I just want to let you know that. Yep. We knew that. You heard us. And you also said fuck Josh Whedon.
That happened.
But what I'm here to say
here.
Is Brian.
It's true. They were ahead of the curve, folks.
Listen, so what I'm saying is I'm a Mace Windu advocate in 2021. And I am here to bring back Mace Windu, aka Samuel Jackson, or a prequel. I'm here to present to you all an opportunity to bring back some melanin midichlorian. Okay, that is what I'm here to help you all with. All right, so
Samuel
just
letting
y'all know. Every other episode, you might hear me say something about ways to bring back Mace Windu. Hey. Don't worry about it. Just repost it and listen.
I'm here.
Just go with it.
I'm here for it. I'm here to support it. Cause
Samuel L. Jackson. Listen, motherfucker, sign on to do a Mace Windu. I know that. With any other actor, when I harassed Dwayne The Rock Johnson and I told him not to show up with his bag of weights, I was pretty respectful. But I think you'll respect me calling you motherfucker if anybody would. So, you know,
English, motherfuckers, do you speak it?
Right. Yeah. Just Mace Windu. Damn. Do you want to be it? Just do it. I mean, that's all you got to do.
I mean, I also need to point out, I've loved Star Wars for a long time, and then I met Marcus, and like Marcus is the biggest Mace Windu fan I have now met, and I feel like that says a lot of just how these characters can just get to you.
Yes.
So I'm here for it. I'm supporting.
Let me just
Marcus.
Go on my spiel real quick. Listen,
okay, do it.
Go Mace Windu, real quick.
Let's do it.
Let me tell you why I'm a Mace Windu advocate. Mace Windu is single-handedly probably one of the strongest Jedi on the fucking council. He went and took on. Wait a minute. First, before we even get there, he told motherfuckers no about Anakin. He knew from the jump and was like, hey, no. And Qui-Gon was like, no, but look at the midichlorian count. He was like, yeah, but bitch, no. I said no. And it was like, no, but we should train him. And so they convinced even Yoda punk ass, the leader of the damn the thing, when they go to exile on himself on Dagobah. Yeah. So like he went and they bought him on. And the whole time, guess who was skeptical the most of Anakin? It was motherfucking Mace Windu.
He knew.
Like, no, we can't make him a master. He not ready. And he told Anakin, if you be patient, you know what I mean? Be patient. We're going to give you an opportunity. I'm going to trust you. Anakin couldn't even do that goddamn shit, right?
Nope.
So then he goes in. They slice and dice the other two Jedi Masters. Mace Windu goes in and single-handedly takes down the Darth City. The leader of it.
Oh, yes.
He takes down the leader of it, holds off a lightning strike, okay? Holds down a lightning strike, and the only reason this motherfucker lost was because Anakin's going through puberty.
I have to save her.
So he slices off Mace Windu's hand and gets flown out a window.
Yep.
Every Windu gets flown out a window. Sorry.
Who's going to be like, if that was intentional?
Say that 10 times fast.
So but there's a reason that he's alive because he just doesn't have a hand. And everybody gets a hand replaced. And lightning, he could have landed on a flying car. There were so many flying cars out there.
He's out there.
Anything could have happened. He's out
Darth
there. Maul that's all
was
I'm
cut
saying.
In half. So now,
Darth Maul was cut in half and came back.
Come on.
And Brian, like Brian mentioned, with spider legs. So it's not like it's outside of the realm of possibility that he landed on.
Dude had spider legs and he was fine.
Yeah, he was
Black Jedi,
fine.
Purple lightsaber. He has to be a Q dog. I mean, the fuck? I mean, he ball head too. Like, I don't know what else you want from me. Bring back Mace Windu.
All right. Just bring him back. Just that's if you could take anything from this podcast, take it back. Bring him back. The last thing that I have for news is relatively uneventful. But if those of you feel comfortable traveling, and eventually we will all feel comfortable traveling, Disneyland has announced that its Avengers campus will open this year.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So what I think is interesting about that is it was scheduled to open in March. Then everything got delayed, construction got delayed, but they just announced in an email that went out to, I think it's D23 fans.
Yeah.
They sent out an email to all their fans, like, we hope you're ready. Like, it's going to open, like, it's going to open this year. And basically the feeling is that people will be able to visit Avengers. What do they call it? The Avengers campus before the end of this year is out. Now the year's a long time. It just started, but before the year is out. So, you know, Disney, you're listening. And I know you're listening. Look, you have three different demographics on this podcast.
One's black.
Four demographics on this podcast. So as far as I'm concerned, if you were smart, right before you open, you would invite us with our radio, with our equipment. You would invite us to Avengers Campus to get everybody a behind-the-scenes peek of what they can expect when they show up to the Marvel's campus.
I mean, that's good business.
I'm not trying to be an ass here, but come on. Come on. I mean, with the love that we've given you. Yeah, with the love that we've given you over the course of the this podcast, we feel like we've kind of earned this one.
There's nobody else that deserves it better. I'm with you.
You find us. You know where you can find us. Just let us know. We'll book our ticket. I mean, I'll even book my own hotel room. Just you get me.
Hey,
there.
Slow down.
Hey,
not everybody. I'll do it. Not everybody else.
Listen, if you bring me on that campus, take me to the Star Wars galaxy, so I can get a Mace Windu lightsaber.
That's very true. Yeah,
we can.
At this point in time, I think he's kind of earned it. Anyway,
you can kill two birds with one stone.
Any more news that we have set to cover this week?
Hell no.
I got nothing.
Okay. Cool. So here's what we got. So I am set. So this week it is my turn to pick the movie for next week. So before we get into what are we reading, what are we watching, I want to tell what all of you can watch for next week's podcast. So back in 2020 in December, there was a movie that was released called Arch Enemy, starring Joe Manganiello. He plays this guy called Max Fist, who apparently may be an alien, maybe a superhero. We don't really know. It's kind of like weird and kind of out there, but that is the movie that we are going to watch for next week. It's available everywhere. It's about like a $7 rental, so it's not crazy. It's not too bad. But that's what we're going to watch and talk about for next week. So make sure that you check that out before you listen to the podcast that'll drop next week. But we also love to plug what we are reading and what we are watching. So Marcus, what are you reading? What are you watching that you recommend to our listeners?
I've been watching a lot. I've been watching a lot of HBO Max.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I can't really tell you what to watch. I watch a little Power Rangers. I'm all over the place. I'm just trying to get back more into watching. I did start a new series with my dad while I was going down there. Bridgerton on Netflix.
Oh, sure.
Oh, yes.
Pretty good series. Everybody's talking about it. It's one of those like Shonda Rhimes creation kind of shows. But
oh, sure.
Really good show. Really, so far, I like it. The representation is really off because it's like back in the day, but black people are just walking around like they're free. So I don't know how that works, but whatever. So there's that. Other than that, I think I'm going to get back into some more Superman, some Smallville. I kind of want to go back to my roots and get that going. And reading, I have an audio book. Oh, yeah. Doug actually got me a cool book, and it is, I'm not reading it, but I'm kind of watching it, but it's Marvel hip hop covers for Christmas. So I've been going through that. I've been reading this new book by Elizabeth Acevedo, and that's a really good book too as well. It's called When the Plane Lands or something like that. I have the title right next week.
Oh, good.
Good book, and that's what I'm reading.
Yeah. And if the USPS would actually get their shit together, Brian could get his Christmas present and talk about that. Yeah. But since USPS has no information for me about anything ever anywhere, well, we'll stand by.
It's fine. I am. Good things come to those who wait, and I'm happy to wait.
Okay, good. Brian, what are you reading? What are you watching?
So I had such a good break reading and watching stuff. I finished reading the book Ahsoka, inspired by me watching Mandalorian. I finished my audiobook Skyward with all right. the fighter jets. And I'm currently reading Thrawn. I got like 100 pages left of that. So I finished two books, got like 3/4 of the way through Thrawn. So I'm reading. It's great. It's nice to have time to read. And then what am I watching? So I'm kind of just taking it easy. I'm watching Rebels Disney Plus, again, inspired from Mandalorian. That show is absolutely for children. And I'm getting through that, but very painfully aware it is for children. And we'll see if it gets better throughout the season. And to balance it out, I've also started watching The Wire on HBO Max.
Oh, man, that is I want to see how those interact in your brain in a dream.
My dreams are weird. Like, I have the kid content of Rebels, and then I have the very adult
red tops,
content.
Blue tops, WMDs.
Yeah,
but with lightsabers.
It's just lightsabers and Rebels animated characters. So my dreams are fun. But that is what I'm reading and watching right now.
Fantastic.
Matt Wagner, what are you reading and what are you watching?
I have read a couple of different books, and just really quickly, I say I read them, but I listened to them via an audiobook, because for all of you like purists out there that are like, oh man, you didn't really read it, you listened. You know something? Fuck you. I read it. I listened to it start to finish. Yeah. So
listening to a book, you consumed it.
So I read a book called The Guest List by Lucy Foley. It was a mystery about a murder that takes place at a wedding in Ireland, which was really, really good. So I listened to that on the way up to Brittany's family for the holiday. And then thanks to Brian, I've been listening to The Magicians for the way down. And one, I didn't realize Brian didn't tell me that it was like a 19-hour audiobook.
Oops.
So I still have a considerable portion of that book. But this is like, imagine that Harry Potter like had sex and drank and got into trouble and just didn't give a shit and kind of like was like, oh man, I gotta walk like really dangerous situations, but as a magician. So it's legit. Like, it's super cool. I've also been reading some comics via the Marvel Unlimited app.
Nice.
I've gotten super into the Vader series there to provide some more glimpse into what happens after Anakin becomes Darth Vader, which is really, really cool. Started reading some Ghost Rider. So I'm reading the Ghost Rider that was rebooted when he's in the car.
Robbie Reyes.
Yes, the Robbie Reyes Ghost Rider. So I've been reading that, which is legit. And then what am I watching? We are watching The Queen's Gambit on Netflix. And we're also watching, I rewatched Ready Player One the other day. So that's what I'm getting into. Before we get into plugs, I have a shout out to give. So as some of you know, and this is kind of a plug, kind of not. So, but as you know, we started a Patreon, multiple tiers. One of them is tier two. And I got a shout out to Chris Schultens. Chris Schultens has been a avid supporter from day one.
Hell yeah.
And Chris signed up. He's a tier two supporter. So we got to shout him out and recognize and give some love over to Chris for supporting us as we go through this journey. Also got to support, like, shout out to Chris. He started a comic book like reading group on Facebook, which is super cool. So they're getting into a House of M, House of X type stuff. So
that's
kind of fun. Yeah, it's really, really cool to kind of get into. So just shout out to Chris, doing the most, helping us do what we love to do. So thank you so much for all of that. But gentlemen, anything that we have to plug for this week? Brian, kick us off.
I'll start off. I'm gonna start plugging our Patreon. So one of the things that we are starting this year with season two, we have a Patreon. And if you don't know what a Patreon is, it is a way that you can support us online. We're gonna have it linked. We're gonna have it on our Twitter, wherever you get your podcasts, and you can go there. You can see what we're doing. We have different levels of investment and support. Say you don't want to buy a cup of coffee this week, and instead you want to support independent art creators like us commentating on things. And this isn't going to be commentary you get anywhere else. Where are you going to find people advocating for a Mace Windu Disney Plus series? I'm going to say nowhere.
Not too many places.
This is genuine, authentic, real-time response to films and pop culture and giving it the lens it needs. So if you want to keep supporting us, making sure that we have the equipment we need, having the website takes money to keep up and running. You can donate to us through our Patreon, and that's what it can do. There are so many different levels. I'm not going to list them all here, but I'm going to plug that. Go check out our Patreon. If you got $5, maybe skip the Starbucks if you're going to order it, and you can give it to us and make sure that our website stays up for like
and,
5 months.
And we're trying to help you reach your health goals. Look, it's 2021. Everybody's New Year's resolution is to get skinny. What do you think they put in that Frappuccino? They ain't putting air and skim milk and fat-free shit. That stuff is filled with like premium sugar and ultra-fat milk. So just skip it. Do yourself a favor and give it to some people who are going to advocate for, you know, a Mace Windu movie. Like, just put it where it belongs.
And giving you the news with the spin that resonates with you, and looking out for these all these types of intersectional lenses, making sure that we're supporting people like Ray Fisher. So that's the first thing I want to plug. The second thing is, of course, as always, thelovenerds.com. Maybe you want to check out something new to eat. Maybe you want to check out a new craft. This would be a great time to do that. Check out thelovenerds.com.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Marcus.
Thank you, Ray.
Marcus, what do you have?
I'm also going to promote our Patreon.
if you
support us, okay, and I say this with love, if you motherfuckers support these motherfuckers, then shit, pay that money. That's all. Listen, where else will you get top-notch quality? We have already upped the ante, you know what I mean? So, like, hold on. Yeah. Matter of fact, you know what I'm saying? Like, we hold on.
He has a very specific song for this.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
We
have already upped the ante here, okay? We're already going to the next level. We are here, okay? Doug Wagner has put in a lot of work for this Patreon and for this podcast in general. And like I said, I'm here to play sidekick. You know what I mean? I'm here to just give my piece. But where else will you get top-notch quality content? Links from Brian Rouse directing you to every article we can find. Prominent sources for things.
Yep.
Doug Wagner guiding us, leading the conversation. Here hosting late night TV show kind of way. Marcus Destin being black and just one fine motherfucker. So listen, you just gotta support us. Mace Windu, we got Marvel news. We gonna say fuck Josh Whedon. We gonna say fuck defund the police. We gonna say fuck everybody storming the
Capitol. Everybody.
We gonna get all this shit off. You know what I mean? And if you a nasty motherfucker, then pay that $20, pay that $10, or pay that $15, pay that $5, and ride with us when we say fuck these nasty motherfuckers, because that is where you gonna get it the best. Now, I mean, if you thought the audio was good, wait till you see the video. Okay?
The video's where it's at. Yeah, I really cannot bring any more energy than that. But seriously, check out the Patreon. We got a ton of good stuff on there. We want to see y'all. I mean, where else are you going to be able to watch the faces that Brian Rouse makes when Marcus says the word, you know, fuck Josh Whedon? Like, those glances that you get, it looks like a deer in headlights sometimes. So you're not going to be able to see those anywhere else.
Whoop your kid's ass.
Or would you tell somebody to whoop some little kid's ass?
Yes. That happened.
Just check it out. It's worth it. It helps us keep this ship afloat. So seriously, check that out, and we would sincerely appreciate it. Look, as always, we have a holy trinity of success here on Filmed in Black and White. And to be honest with you, the first step is very, very simple. Just drink some goddamn water.
Yes, please.
It's drier out there. It's the wintertime. You know, hydrate yourself. It helps your mind. It helps your bones. It helps your body. So just drink your water. Get your hydration. And don't just drink, you know, Sprite ain't water. There's water in it, but it ain't water. So just, it may look like bubbly water, but it's not. So just
not champagne.
Drink your water. Brian, what's the next step to success?
Y'all need to read a book. And I'm not saying this because I'm on a book high and I finished two books on my break here. I'm saying you can read anything. Just read, whether it's a news piece, maybe it's a short story. You don't have to have a prestige with it. You don't have to finish War and Peace, or you don't have to finish.
It could be an audiobook.
It could be an audiobook. Like, whatever it is, get that experience into your brain so you can reflect on it and grow as a person.
Yeah. And Marcus, take us home. What's the third key to success here?
Welcome to season two, motherfuckers. Listen, listen, you know the third rule. If you're new here, I'll be glad to give it to you, okay? The third rule is wash that ass, okay? Please. Wash your ass. A lot of y'all stormed the Capitol today. You didn't wash your ass, and we smelled you coming down the hallway.
No.
All right, that's stinky. You're nasty.
Smell you coming.
They smelled you coming from a mile away. If you washed your ass, maybe you would have actually gotten the chamber. Who knows? Yeah. But you.
We don't need any Pepe Le Pew action here. Just wash your ass.
We smell. We're wafting next to the flags in the Constitution. You're just burning paper at this point because your ass not washed. Right. It don't take much. You know what I mean? Just put a soap. A bar of soap and a towel right up the crack of your ass, right? And listen, not just the crack of your ass, but you got to put it in your armpits.
Underneath.
Wash your feet, because when you take them socks off, that shit stinks and it smells like athlete's foot. Okay,
yeah.
So that's the last step.
Yeah.
Just wash that ass.
So there you have it. Drink some water, read a book, wash your ass. You know what you got to do. Just do it. Ooh. Welcome to season two, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for joining us this week. We are so excited you're joining us. We'll be back next week to review Arch Enemy. But in the meantime, stay safe, stay healthy. We love y'all. We appreciate y'all. And we will catch y'all next week.